Hi, and welcome to The Briefing Book, the first in an occasional podcast series from the Parliament of Victoria, where we examine the big policy issues facing the state and look at what our elected representatives are doing to address them. I'm Bill Bainbridge, a communications advisor here at the Parliament. Today, children of incarcerated parents. At any one time, perhaps 7,000 Victorian children find themselves serving a sentence, not because they've committed a crime, but because one or both of their parents has been incarcerated. I use the very imprecise perhaps because the truth is we don't know exactly how many children are in this situation. That reflects the general lack of government data and academic research in the area, but the Legislative Council's Legal and Social Issues Committee is working to change that. The committee has just tabled a report following an extensive examination, and here to talk about that report is the committee chair and member for the Northern Metropolitan Region, Fiona Patten. Welcome, Fiona.
Thank you, Bill.
So, Fiona, can we start with how you came to be holding this inquiry? Who referred the inquiry?
In the end, Bill, it was a self-referral. So the committee actually agreed to do this investigation and this inquiry. But it came out of some very passionate advances to us from Rod Barton, the member for Eastern Metropolitan. He'd certainly put this on the notice paper that he wanted to the committee to investigate this. The committee agreed with Rod that this was a really important issue, and we were very happy to self-refer.
And so you heard some pretty harrowing tales. Can you tell me a little bit about some of the people who shared their stories with the committee?
We heard from such a wide range of people, and you know, it's one of the privileges of being on a parliamentary committee is that you get to meet people from all walks of life. So we met with people who had had parents in prison.
My name is Rachel. Both my parents have conviction histories, and my dad was incarcerated for the majority of his life and died after a police-initiated contact a few years ago.
And learned about their experiences and what that did to their lives.
I think that there were a lot of difficulties maintaining meaningful connection from prison, and I think a lot of people are incarcerated for things that they shouldn't be. A lot of people who are incarcerated are on remand and not necessarily sentenced, and all of these things affect families and affect children in ways that I don't think are currently being recognised.
We also spoke to parents who were in prison and the impact that that had on their relationships with their children.
I'm John Jacoma. I said as a result of me being taken out of their lives for 6.5 months, it really affected them. It still affects them today.
And a number of those people also reflected on being children of incarcerated parents and talked about that. And then we also got to speak to experts in the field, not just here in Australia, but in New Zealand and also in Scotland.
My own organisation in Scotland, Families Outside, provides training for teachers, for example, where we take teachers into prisons to experience what a visit is like and then run the workshops with them in the prison visits hall.
I guess if the listeners can imagine a young child sitting at home, the door gets bashed down, there's yelling and screaming, and your father is thrown to the floor by a number of police officers. Toys are strewn across the place, and then your father or your mother or whoever your parent is then hauled out of the house and taken down to the station and arrested. And you've just witnessed this. Then it goes through sentencing, and then that person is incarcerated. You have just lost, quite often, the breadwinner of your family or the significant carer in your family. This means quite often you are then put into care because you've got no one to look after you. It disrupts your school. It means that you may need to move home. It means that you may have home insecurity. It means that, you know, possibly the breadwinner no longer is there. So it's very disruptive. there's a stigma around it. There's a lot of shame. So quite often children didn't want to talk about it. So it affects everything in their lives. And then to try and maintain that relationship with their parents, they go through the equally traumatic experience of going into a prison and visiting their parents. And sometimes these are extremely difficult circumstances.
And in your foreword, you say that children affected by parental incarceration are the invisible victims of crime. What do you mean by that, invisible?
You know, at no point does anyone have a line of sight on these children. You know, we spoke to police and we certainly spoke to people who had been arrested. At no time is there any thought, is there a child there? Now, there will be times when that does happen because of the particular individual, but there's no policy around that. When they go through the sentencing, there's no weight or consideration put on the parental status of that person and the impact that incarceration will have on the children of that person. And then when you look at the prison systems, you know, there's been some attempts to make some of the visiting areas more children friendly, but we've got a long way to go there. You know, we heard of children being left in a car when a parent was arrested because no one thought to ask that person if they had children. There's no policy, there's no department, there's no place where there is a consolidated and joined up view of this person, of this child.
So who generally does the heavy lifting? Is it grandparents or relatives?
It'll be grandparents, it'll be relatives, or the other parent. Yes, for the most part. You know, and that can work, but you know, sometimes when someone is incarcerated, relationships can be frayed. You know, we spoke to women whose mothers were not all too happy that they now had two young children to be looking after, and the relationship with that parent may have been fraught to begin with. So yes, it does. It falls on families, and we certainly saw that in the Aboriginal community, that kinship was really important.
My name is Mary Bamblett, but more importantly, I'm a Yorta Yorta Shadjarung Kangarong Wurrung woman from Victoria with rich connections across many of the Aboriginal traditional owner groups within Victoria. But I think the biggest challenge I find in child protection is the absence of understanding the role of men, Aboriginal men, yeah, or men generally in parenting. Mm. And there's particularly in the poverty cycle, you see the absence of really understanding the importance. We see much better outcomes when there are two parents involved in the raising of children. And so I think it's really important to understand. And there are too many Aboriginal men in prison and absent from parenting children. And despite, you know, mum doing her best, quite often we can see in the dark where dad's involved in the parenting, you get better outcomes.
But you know, in thinking of Aboriginal children, we're now removing children from their parents at a greater rate than we were during the stolen generation. It's really disturbing. And, you know, many of these kids end up in out-of-home care.
And one of the findings of your report is that 20% of Aboriginal children can experience parental incarceration compared to just 5% of non-Aboriginal children.
I mean, can you believe that in 2022, that 20% of Aboriginal children will be removed from their parent, or their parent will be removed from them? And not because that parent can't look after them, not because that parent doesn't love them or is doing harm, but because that parent is generally being incarcerated due to poverty, disadvantage, mental health.
And you went into prisons. What did you learn about people trying to maintain relationships with their children while they're in prison? What are the challenges for them there?
Yeah, look, it seemed everyone had a different mechanism to cope and to deal with it. In fact, some people in prison wouldn't tell their children where they were. They were away working, you know, on a mine or out of town. And that works for a little while. But after a while, the child is still wondering why I can't see Dad, why I can't speak to him, why when's Dad coming home or Mum coming home. There were others who really tried to maintain those relationships, but just, you know, the clunky communication systems that are in our prisons make that very difficult. The fact that making a phone call can cost a dollar a minute if you're in a prison. And so this is even beyond the budgets of many of the people in prison. If they have more than one child living in two different locations, they literally have to choose which child they're going to communicate with on that particular week due to financial constraints. Having children come to visit them can be very difficult. You know, going through the security systems at prisons is, you know, it's not easy for an adult, and I've been into a few of them. You know, it's confronting. But thinking of a small child going through that is, you know, for some parents, it's too much, and they just say, please don't bring the children here. So to maintain those relationships, it's so difficult. For some of them who want to, you know, keep up with what they're doing at school, take a part in learning and being parent-teacher nights and things like that, it's just, it has proved insurmountably difficult.
And do prison authorities generally work to facilitate access to children, or not always?
Again, children are just invisible in this bill. You know, there's a, when we asked, you know, how many people in prison have got children? And they came back with a figure of, 20% or something. Now, this was rubbish. Far more people in prison had children than that. But there's no line of sight on these children, nobody even knows how many parents are in prison. Nobody knows how many of them have children being looked after by grandparents or in out-of-home care. So we just don't know. Then, you know, things like visitations, things like phone calls, while they should be seen as a right, quite often in prisons they're seen as a privilege and they're taken away. Now, that doesn't punish the prisoner, that punishes the child who was waiting to speak to their parent on the phone or was waiting to visit them on the weekend.
And so what could be done to make children's visitation to prisons better?
I think this is a really crucial part, and there's a number of things that we can do better. Certainly we can change the environment. And we've seen some beautiful work done overseas where they've really tried to make those visiting areas a lot more child-friendly. Really look at the security systems that we use. You know, we strip search and, you know, and search the person in the prison. Do we really need to search the child? Because we'll be searching the person in prison when they leave that visitation room as well. So there's looking at other options to minimise the kind of personal intrusion and the scariness of having a wand over you, being patted down, having to leave all your toys in a locker. So I think there's lots of areas that we can improve just in the infrastructure of our prison systems. Also just enable more visits. And help with guided visits. You know, have childcare workers there to help parents with a kind of organised play. So this is really crucial. And also, you should never deny a child the right to visit their parent. So regardless of what that parent has done, you cannot take away the right for a child to visit their parent. And that should be a right, and that should never be considered a privilege.
And I think some of the research that you looked at said that a child of an incarcerated parent is more likely to end up in prison themselves.
Yes, and this was excruciating for some of the people that we spoke to with that lived experience. They know that statistic. They, you know, for the people that we spoke to, high achievers, wonderful people doing beautiful things with their lives, contributing to the community, constantly feared that they're going to be arrested. You know, it's not a realistic fear, but it's this constant fear that somehow they're doing something wrong. And those rates, are extraordinary. And in fact, when we were at one of the prisons, we happened to ask the six people that we were speaking to, had they had a parent in prison? 5 out of 6 of them had. And we know this is much higher in our, this is very, very high in our Aboriginal community. But again, very few statistics on it. We've extrapolated some figures, and we do know that the disruption of parental incarceration can disrupt someone's life, and that can lead to a criminal path.
So what are the implications of having such poor data? What flows from that?
I think there's a couple of things. Without the data, we have no way of working out what we can do to help those children. Without that data, we don't even know who those children are. Because in many times, when you look at the demographic of people who are in prison, they are largely people from disadvantaged backgrounds. We know that many people who end up in prison have been in out-of-home care themselves. And for many of them, they are very suspicious of out-of-home care. They're very worried that their children will be taken away from them and they will never get them back. So quite often it's a very casual arrangement that the children go and stay with a relative and no one knows. So we're not offering services to those kids. We're not helping those kids. We're not ensuring that those kids, if they're falling behind in school, are getting the help that they need. So without that data, we can't assist those kids. Without that data, we also can't assist the parents in reintegration and reforming those relationships and taking the opportunity of this time to help parents improve their parenting skills, improve their relationships with their children, get ready to be back, to kind of come back and be able to provide a safe and loving homes for their kids.
So your report makes a number of recommendations to government. What are some of the key recommendations that you'd really like to see followed up?
We would certainly like to see a specific section established in the Department of Health, Housing and Fairness to look specifically at these children, to look at the needs of these children. And it needs to sit across, it needs to be able to talk to education, it needs to be able to talk to corrections, it needs to be able to speak to health, needs to be able to go across different departments. But there needs to be a specific section that does that. We need to, I think, improve our communication systems in our prisons. I mean, it's ridiculous that people are paying $1 a minute to speak on the phone. I don't think anybody, with a mobile phone has ever spent that much money on making phone calls. So we need to improve the communications. We need to update them. We need to enable, email. We need to enable other forms of communication, albeit safely. And I think actually, ultimately, we need to consider why we are incarcerating parents, and particularly women. We are incarcerating Aboriginal women at a higher rate than we ever have, ever in our history. And not for violent crimes.
There's something, you explore something called the Bangkok rule. What's that?
Well, the Bangkok rule is about the child being at the centre of this. So at every point, the child is at the centre. So having police policy to check that there are children, if there are children on the premises, to try and manage that in a way that doesn't traumatise the child. When you're going through the court system and going through sentencing, the child needs to be considered in that, that the right of that child needs to have an equal standing in there. And I think this is where we go to when we're looking at incarcerating parents. Can we look at other opportunities and other options? We're certainly seeing it in other jurisdictions, whether that's sort of electronic controls, whether that's community orders, whether that's just looking at other ways to certainly ensure the safety of our community, but ensure that that child still has a parent to care for them and that we can maintain those family relationships, because we know they are such defence mechanisms for future harm.
Fiona Patten, thanks so much for talking to me.
Thanks, Bill.